It's your girl, DeShonda Carter, but you can call me DC. Thanks so much for tuning in today to my show, When the Blue Comes Off. Sit back, relax, take notes, do what you like, and let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome. Now, I know I always open up my show and I say my very special guest, but this is actually my very, very special guest. And you know why he's my very special guest? Because not only is he the guest of the show, he is the man with the plan who is the CEO, head entrepreneur of the www.totalentradio.com. He allows me to bring this show to you every Thursday, 4 p.m. Eastern. So please, everybody, if you can imagine standing up on your feet, give it up for my man, Mr. Salis Cobb.
Oh my God! Oh, my. I got goosebumps. You gave me goosebumps. That's
Isn't that fly? That's how New York brings it.
I want you to come to the office here in Detroit and say that every day when I walk in.
So, Salis, listen, first of all, I want to thank you so much for taking your time out of your very, very busy, hectic schedule to squeeze us in to be on the show, because I know you're very busy. So let's just jump right into it and talk to the people. Yes.
Let's get to it.
Mr. Salis Cobb, you come out of Detroit, you own a radio, massive production. You do plays. Tell the people about yourself. Tell New York and everybody where else you cover what it
First off, I gotta say, what up, though, to New York, all the way from Detroit, man. It's so much love we got for y'all. You know, my first trip to New York was back in 2004. I know if y'all remember a show called American Idol.
Wow.
And I took the bus out to New York and I fell in love. I fell in love with the culture. I fell in love with the people that I met. And so I guess it was always in my heart to reconnect with y'all as soon as possible. And that opportunity came with Total Entertainment Radio. You know, like you said, I am one of the owners of Total Entertainment Radio. I would say my role is more of the visionary. You know what I'm saying? And that's not to downplay any of the other roles, because they're all very equally important. But God has allowed me to be a person that dreams. You know what I'm saying? And once I got over the fear of going after my dreams, it became lights out for pretty much me and everybody around me.
I know that's right.
So yes, we own Total Entertainment Radio, steady growing online radio station, headquartered out here in Detroit, Michigan. We also run Mustard Seed Productions, a theater stage play production company. And so we just got done with our second stage play production, with the third one on the way in September. I also sit on the board of SES's Designs, which is graphic designs, and SES's also does all of our technical designs for the radio station. And I sit on the board of G Suite's personal training program, where we incorporate fitness and health into our daily lifestyles. And we use the radio station also to promote that as well. So like you said, I guess I'm a little bit busy, but God is good, you know?
Well, it sounds like you're doing way too much. How do you have time to even eat? Like, when do you get to do that?
I don't. I fast. I'm just playing. to be honest with you, time management is a thing. I think I'm a firm believer that, you know, time managed properly can pretty much open up anything to you. I I come from a family of hard workers, right? You know, Detroit, you know, we were known for our hustle, right?
Right.
And so I knew how to hustle, but what I didn't know was how to manage my time. When I started making decisions that brought out the best out of my time, mountains really began to move. So I guess to answer your question, it's really through time management. It really is. And time management is not only just, you know, knowing how much time to put in, but it's also knowing how much time to take out. You know, sometimes I have to make myself take a break, make myself sit down, make myself, right, you know, clear my head and get back to center. I was watching something on TV, and he said, and it was a guy on there talking about how important it is to get your mind back to its center. And so, yeah, time management even includes that. But once you do, man, once you become a master of your time and a master of self-growth, then you become almost a master of your destiny, I believe.
Well, first of all, before I elaborate on that statement, I want you to know, they say New Yorkers talk fast. You talk
fast. We hold it. I try to get as many words in as I can.
Jesus. I'm like, okay. You the road runner of the verbal. Okay? But I agree with you. Now, one thing I would say about time management, like for me, that is something that I definitely try to focus on, because I feel like in my latter years, I have realized I have not been clinically diagnosed, but in my mind, I believe I have ADHD, because I am all over the place. Like, an idea come to my head, I write it down. I'm one of those people I write down on scraps of paper, and I'll have scratch paper. It's my chaos, and I understand it. But
at least you write it down. That's good.
I have to, because I learned how to, because I forget. And ever since I started doing this show, this wonderful tool that one of your workers had supplied me with, right? The audio, I leave a lot of voice clips to myself too.
That must have been Ann.
Yes, of course it was Angela.
She's the voice note queen.
Because I will forget, and it's like, oh my God, what did I just say? I can be in a conversation and talking to you, but my mind will drift off and I have a thought about something. I'm like, oh my God, what was I just thinking?
It's funny that she suggested it to you, right? Because y'all kind of similar in that aspect. And the thing that I've learned about, you know, people like you and Ange is, y'all be having million-dollar ideas.
Right.
Y'all really do. And so, like I said, congratulations on getting them down on anything, because you never know which one of them is going to be your next rocket. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And definitely writing stuff. We write all the time. It's stuff posted all over our walls. It's stuff all in our phones. Like, that is one thing that we learn. And I would say, honestly, and growing Total Entertainment Radio, writing things down was probably the number one tool that caused us to grow. We were sending money out of the window because we were just forgetting who we were talking to. You know what I'm saying? And so just incorporating a system where we write down who we talk to has not only saved us money, it's made extra money, and it's allowed us to get back in contact with people that we did make money with, you know, just for writing it down. So, yeah, that's definitely something that you want to hold on to. And you're so talented, Deshonda. I should be interviewing you.
Well, we're gonna switch, right? I'm going to come.
Oh, we're going to switch. Okay.
And I'm going to come, and you're going to interview me.
I'm tempted to interview you right now.
No. Not today. This is all about you, Mr. Cobb. It's all about you. Now, let me ask you. I heard you say, you know, you have some partners and you have several businesses. So what made you initially come up with the idea to start your own radio station? Where did that idea come about?
We started. Okay, let me take you back to the beginning. You may or may not believe this. So I had just moved back from out of Detroit. I stayed in a smaller city called Pontiac, Michigan, about 40 miles north of Detroit. I had moved out there for about 10 years, and I'm not a church man, right? But I got a relationship with God. So me and God talking, we praying, I'm praying and stuff like that. And God telling me, like, you know, you about to have to go back to the city. make a long story short, I get back to the city and I don't know what I'm coming to. All of a sudden, a young lady that I grew up with comes in my inbox on Facebook, asks me, have I ever been interested in radio? She think I'd be good at it. So I took a meeting with her at a radio station around here. And she, you know, she convinced me to do the show. We did the show there for about 6 months. At the end of the 6 months, another friend of mine had informed me of what I would learn to be online radio. I had never even heard of it before. And so she was like, yeah, it's online radio, and it's ran through the website. And so you'll be able to get people to listen to whatever you're doing from all over the world. So I had to go see it to believe it. I ended up signing my next contract with an online radio station here in Detroit, and they were running the reports, you know, of our numbers and stuff. And I'm looking at the maps, and I'm like, get out of here. We got people listening from New York. We got people listening from Atlanta. We got people listening all over the country. I'm like, man, get out of here. So then the nail in the coffin was COVID. Because when we were signed with the online radio station here in Detroit, they end up closing down for COVID. And as soon as they closed down for COVID, God said, all right, it's time for you to open up. And mm-hmm. we opened up, and we literally opened up Total Entertainment Radio in my apartment. Sound crazy, but we got a couple desks, we got a couple computers, we set up some scheduling stuff, and we did all of our interviews virtually in the apartment. And it began to catch. Everybody was at home during COVID and everything, and so we were making contacts with a lot of people all over the country. And ever since then, we just been stepping it up another level. We, you know, opened up our first office here in Detroit. We just opened up our second office down in Jacksonville about a month ago, and hopefully it's more to come. Just on working the things that we have, right, and still being able to plan for our future. And I think that's really been the two things that we've been really good at, working what we have and planning our future. So we're smart enough, right, to understand that we have things that have value, so they need to be worked. But we're wise enough not to be complacent and to know that we still have to keep building our future. And that's really what Total Entertainment Radio really was about. It was about building everybody's future. That's how all the other companies really came along. You know, Mustard Seed Productions, G Suite's Training, SES Designs, they were all more struggling companies before Total Entertainment Radio. But once we took charge of getting the word out about us, man, everything began to change.
Wow. See, that's the great thing about having a team and having the right people in your circle. Now, you said you don't necessarily have to be churchy, right? But you believe in the Most High. So with you having that faith and that belief and coming together, it's very important to have people of like mind around you, right?
Absolutely.
Because when you are the smartest person in the room and you're the only person contributing to your ideas, every idea you may come up with is a good one because there's nobody here for you to talk to, mm-hmm. to say, to work it out, to be like, oh, nah, we gonna go with the first one. The second one don't sound too good, you know?
Mm-hmm. And you know, one of the things that you said something about being, you know, when not having somebody to bounce those ideas off of.
Right.
And I just really want to elaborate on that because, you know, that's so important. We had a slogan that we used to use around us, me, Kayla, and Ange, and that's iron sharpens iron.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And I think about ideas sort of like iron. Because no matter what the idea is, how good or bad, right, it's still going to need sharpening.
Right.
It's still going to need some fine tuning. I think the thing that I've been blessed to be around, right, is people where God has been able to show me their what's the word I'm looking for?
Their vision.
Their super. I think everybody has a superpower.
Right. I agree.
And so we're able to put together our unique superpowers, right? And still, because, you know, at the end of the day, even though I'm the visionary, being a visionary could be my superpower, right? Calling people back on time is not my superpower. So, but calling people back on time is way more important than being a vision. You can have all the vision in the world. If you can't make your phone calls on time, baby, you know that vision going to be slow to come. Right. And so when you understand, or when you're with a group, when you have a team that understands what's important, as well as what their superpowers are, and allow the other people in the group to have their superpowers, you really got something going. And I think that's what's been the biggest blessing about the team here at Total Entertainment Radio. And that's just not us three, that's y'all too. You know, right. You, Angel, our other host or whatever, y'all have superpowers. The way that you come up with an idea, Kashonda, that's a superpower. You know what I'm saying? I may have the vision to be able to see it coming, but you got the idea. And so they're both superpowers. And if we work them together, man, it's almost like the Power Rangers when they put together the big dinosaur. Can't nothing stop it, you
right?
Know?
But people have to have the right mindset when it comes to that. See, my biggest problem with people, and more so, I find this to be with women. Now, my forte is working with women and children. Right, that's my biggest platform. Like, I love it. Right, but what I find when I speak to women or women that have groups, it's so many of us, right? Because everybody wants to be in charge.
Yes.
Right?
Absolutely.
I don't always want to be in charge, right? Because people don't realize to have your name on a monument, to have your name on a building, to have your name as the person in charge, that comes with significant responsibility.
Let me tell you something, Shonda. They had to beg me to put my picture on the flyer. You understand what I'm saying? If there's one thing that I understand is that with great power comes even greater responsibility.
Right.
And if I, to be honest with you, if Salis Cobb III had his choice, I'd be the best number two on the planet. You understand what I'm saying? I would get you everything that you need and everything, you know, but, you know, sometimes God be like, nah, man, it's time to be number one, you know, but only because I think because of the humility that I have with it, that I'm willing to, even when I do have a number one spot, I'm really understanding that I'm not here without at least one or two other people. And so it's more like we got a number one spot. You know what I'm saying? But it's not always what it's cracked up to be. It's really not. You know, like you said, it's a lot of responsibility. The buck stops with you. And that's not always good news. So I guess what I would say is, you know, just know your role, know your lane, whatever it is, and be a master at it. You know, I've had to be number three. I've had some of the worst bosses on the planet. You hear what I'm saying? I've had to follow instructions that were like, wow, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, but at the same time, it taught me how to learn how to respect authority, right? Because even though I may not be in the position that I think I deserve, if somebody else is, that is at least deserving of a level of respect. And when you learn to do that, I think sometimes God allows the doors to be, or the path to be clear for you, for you now to be in position maybe to capitalize on some of those mistakes that somebody else may have made. When you're working as a group, especially with women, you know, you all women are, this is y'all season.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know what I'm saying? It really is. They can, when I say they, I mean society and its norms, they can no longer shun y'all out of places or cover y'all up or silence you all's voices. And so I think what we're seeing now is just an influx of women, generations of women that have now really understood that their voice is now free. And so that's really one of the big reasons why Total Entertainment operates, because for me, it's simple. You know, and it may not work for everybody, don't get me wrong, but for me, let them talk. Let them talk. She want to talk, let her say something. What she want, a show, a commercial, what? You can say something on anything.
Right.
Only because, like I said, historically, you all's voices had to endure such intentional silencing.
Yes.
That now that those some of those barriers are removed, I think it's therapeutic. to be honest with you. I think you should be talking. You all's daughters are going to hear you talk. Some of us in our situation, we come from mothers and grandmothers that we had to watch not be able to talk and watch not to be able to have a voice. But not our daughters and our granddaughters. They're going to be able to see y'all have a voice. And I think that's powerful.
Very powerful. And speaking of that, even with me having a granddaughter, right?
She's so beautiful. I see her on Facebook too.
Thank you. She's actually
such a cutie pie.
She's downstairs. I had to leave her downstairs and close the door. She was like, "Well, what's going on?" Like, she couldn't understand. Like, I had to lock her out for a minute because she would have been conducting an interview. So I'm grooming her. I'm grooming her for nothing but success, because at the end of the day, you know, like you said, generationally, right? From the people, our ancestors, they weren't able to do, and each generation should be better and better and better. And I think we're in a place in time now that by us being able to become plethoras of knowledge and able to share it, it's not like locally anymore. We can reach the masses with information, right?
Absolutely. And don't let nobody make you think otherwise.
Right. Because there's resources that'll say, no, there's no reason for anyone to feel that they cannot get the education or the information that they need to become successful.
Absolutely. Even if you go to YouTube University.
Right. And you can get all kinds of degrees on YouTube University. I agree.
Absolutely.
I agree. But, you know, so now we have you have this, you have an online radio station. You have helped and natured, is that the word I want to use? Yes, natured. So many other people, and allowing them to now have shows on your network. What is the goal for TotalENTRadio.com? What do you foresee and want it to be in the next 5 years?
In the next 5 years, it's going to sound crazy, and I may even sound like a broken record. But for, in the next, I'll say this first. At this point, right now, let's say year one. My number one focus with the shows is to really solidify all of the connections. We have so many hosts. I'm just going to start naming. Come help me out.
Introduce who you asking to help out. Like, you got people in the studio with you. Like, let the people know who you got there with you.
It's my team. I go nowhere without them.
Okay. All right, team, chime in and help them out.
But you know, this is G Sweet. I say, hey, G Sweet.
Hi, Deshonda.
Hi.
How you doing?
I'm good. I can't wait to get out to Detroit. I cannot wait so we can do a little live broadcast and get it popping.
I'll be talking you up here, Deshonda. I know you are itching and ready to get
not as much as I'm itching. I'm over here like a thing.
Yes, I want to get to that Motor City. Y'all guys don't even know. I've never been, and I'm really excited to have the connections. And then when we come back after we finish this segment, we're going to talk about the plays and what, you know, goals for that. So we're not going to talk about that right now. So we're going to finish this up. So tell me.
Okay. No, what I was saying, though, you know, we got New York, mm-hmm. Baltimore, the DMV, Chicago, mm-hmm. Birmingham, Alabama, Florida. Jacksonville, Florida, St. Louis, Missouri. Okay. My number one goal is to connect those dots to China.
Okay.
Like nobody's business. I love what you all have been doing as far as collaboration and collaborating on each other's things. But my goal is to make that collaboration even more solid. You know, Total Entertainment Radio, Deshonda, I come from a history of the arts too.
Okay.
So my first art was writing. My second art was acting. My third art was dancing. But dancing was probably my best art. I did it for the longest.
What type of dancing?
Whatever, all of it. I did ballet. I did jazz. I did hip hop. I danced behind some artists. I mean, I danced for artists that were Simon No Limit. Local artists around here. This was back in my old days. and dancing. You know what? And I even did some stripping. I stripped for about 3 years.
Oh, Lord! Listen, we can't. This is family. radio. Don't be talking about your
Oh, yeah. Thing. I'm not going to. You might have to edit that one out.
But, you know, I the reason why I say that is because I've been blessed enough to experience so much in the entertainment realm. Then that's really what birthed Total Entertainment Radio. And so even though we put a radio behind it, it still was purposed and designed to give people a total entertainment experience. And that's entertainment from all genres, from all walks of art, right? You know, we've been teaming up with local painters and artists, you know what I'm saying? Because even that, in my eyes, is part of entertainment. Entertainment through song, entertainment through dance, entertainment through talk shows. It's all a part of our entertainment. And here's the thing, historically, our people, any people, has been able to survive by the stories that we pass on to our up and coming generations. And so this entertainment realm is no different than just us passing our stories, but to generations all around the country. You know what I'm saying? And you hit it right you hit the nail right on the head when you said it earlier, that, you know, no longer is a state line a barrier for us. And mm-hmm. So not only will your story be heard by your grandbaby out there in New York, your story going to be heard by my baby here in Detroit, and your story going to be heard by other grandbabies down in Jacksonville. And that gives us power. When we know what we can do, when we know what we're capable of, then the people that come after us can take that torch and really blaze a trail with a foundation that's solid. You know, we don't have to start from scratch no more as a people. We don't have to start from scratch no more. And that's what Total Entertainment is really designed to do, so that whoever comes and takes over the realm, they don't have to start from scratch, and they can keep building it to be bigger and better than we could ever dream.
Wow, Salis, like that was the perfect way to end that segment, because it was so profound, and it captured everything as what you said. You know what I mean? Like, in the next 5 years, we're connecting the dots from state to state. Yes. And hopefully and prayfully, there may be some other states acquired along the way.
I believe so. You know, we've had talks with some people from Texas. And you know, I was trying not to spread ourselves too thin.
Right.
But, you know, God showed me something about a year or two ago. And he said, if you got the faith to believe it, I got the grace to do it. And so that's what we're operating on God's grace, right? And so everything that is allowed for us to do, you know, we're going to plan on doing. And we have no box. there's no box to put us in. So whatever that may be, you know, it's about us being prepared and ready, like I said, to do that. And when people, you know, when people start, well, I guess we'll talk about it when we talk about the plays. But, yes. You know, one of the things that just really sends me over the edge when I see with y'all is watching y'all when y'all see each other face to face. When angels saw Lily from St. Louis and St. Louis met DMV, you know, just that meeting alone, right? Opened up so many doors of opportunity, and that's really what it's about. The more opportunities that we have to succeed, the more we will succeed. I promise you that.
Well, I'm going to claim it for you, for me.
I appreciate that.
And we're going to look forward to Total ENT Radio just blowing up, Total Entertainment as a whole blowing up, and getting more people involved. So listen, guys, you already heard Mr. Salis say he ain't looking for people. But if you think you got what it takes, and you might want to get on this train right here, you're going to hit him up, and we're going to give you that information when we come back. Right? And am I right, Salis?
Oh, you are right. You are right. I'm just so happy to be a guest on When the Blue Comes Off.
Well, you know what? Don't go anywhere. We're going to come back and we're going to talk to Salis again about some more entrepreneurial skills and some more entertainment that he's able to provide to the people. So stick around. Don't go away. We'll be back.
This has been brought to you by Simply Carter Corp., your one-stop shop for all of your entertainment and party needs. Contact Simply Carter Corp. for any special occasion. You can find them on Facebook at Simply Carter Corp., on Instagram at Simply Carter Corp. You can check out their website at www.simplycartercorp.com. Give them a call at 845-682-0022, or you can shoot them an email at hello@simplycartercorp.com. Simply Carter Corp., a brand for everyone.
Welcome back. Welcome back. We're here with my very special guest, Mr. Salis Cobb, the owner, the CEO of this radio station, www.totalentradio.com. And we're going to talk to him now about some of his other entrepreneurial skill sets, like playwriting. Like, Salis, what is up with that?
Let's talk about it.
Yes, tell the people about your play. Well, first of all, before you get into about this one specific play that I wanted you to talk about in the promotion, but how did you get into playwriting?
Well, I wrote my first play as a kid. We did a play. I was telling you about, you know, getting over some of my fears. And so I had always had ideas about playwriting, but one of my biggest fears was, right, people seeing what I was thinking, right? And so I had finally got the courage to get over one of those fears around age 15 at my church, and we wrote a play called Temptations. The play did real good, and then I got writer's block, and it was the craziest thing. I went about 10 years, and I didn't write anything, and then all of a sudden, you know, the block came off, the ideas began to flow, and once again, I was able to be back creative to how I used to be, but now, this time, without the fear necessarily of what people will say when they find out what I'm thinking.
Oh, Lord.
I know, right?
So, you would say, so you have this writer's block, you know, mm-hmm. while you were in that space, did you think you would get back to writing? Or did you push it on the back burner?
I definitely put it in the back burner initially. And then it kind of kept coming to me like, you know, Silas, you're going to write again. But I think what it really was that I had to really embrace the maturation process that I was going through, right? Because the thing is, you know, my particular lane as a writer, I believe, is one that's once again inspired by God. And so I knew, even though I may have the skill to write, it may not be a good idea, or it's not a good idea for me to write unless I'm writing something that has purpose. And I kind of think that was probably what was behind the writer's block. My writing didn't really have no purpose, but that 10-12 year gap where I'm living life and I'm learning things and I'm relearning things, because, you know, sometimes we relearn stuff. We thought we knew, you know, some things, and then, you know, we realized that we maybe have to fine-tune what we're thinking and everything. And so, yeah, I relearned some things. And then finally, the purpose that I was looking for behind the writing got there. And that made the writing a little bit more serious.
Okay. So now we're here. We've established I'm ready to write again. The Most High keeps putting it in my heart, putting it in front of me. This is something that's inevitable that I'm going to do. Let's talk about the first play.
Yes. First play was called Nobody Wants a Weak Man.
And what made you come up with that? Because I agree. Nobody wants a weak man. I agree. But how you came up with that?
You know, the first play was actually going to be a response to the vagina monologues. Sexuality. And so it was designed. It was designed to give the same, the concept-wise, to give those monologues, but from a male perspective. As I began to develop that play a little bit more, you know, I began to see things about what people was doing. And let's just say I decided to go in another direction as far as calling it the monologues, right? But really, Nobody Wants a Weak Man is a theme. Right? Because everybody agrees. Nobody wants one, right?
Right.
But it's a theme, but it's a theme surrounded by four stories of four different individual men at four different stages of their life. It definitely was a reflection of a lot that was going on in that 10-12 year writer's block period that I went through personally. And to be honest with you, I could even venture off to say that I've lived the lives of all four of these characters at one point in time in those things. And so Nobody Wants a Weak Man was actually something that I lived. One of my ex-girlfriends told me that in one of our arguments, and I ended up using it in the play because it had so much power, you know, at the time. You know, I took it as any man would probably take it, right? If you're telling them this thing. But it was something that I had to learn to accept and change how it was or how I am perceived as a man. You know, we talk about being ourselves, right? And being true to who we are. You know, and that's fine and good, but I believe that there are certain responsibilities as a man, and not just as a man, as a black man, where sometimes we may have to go ahead and control the narrative of who we are. Sometimes we can't just let people think that we are what they think that we are. You know, sometimes we got to go ahead and clear the air just for the sake of people knowing the man that we are. The thing that I love about the characters and Nobody Wants a Weak Man is that in each point they define who they are as a man, and they don't look the same. You know, and to a lot of my fellas out there, I try to tell them, like, you know, being a man don't look the same for everybody. Right. And so, you know, you still have to go down your own road and define who you are as a man and stand by it. And there's nothing wrong with that. You know, don't let people make you feel bad for taking a stand on your manhood, because in my opinion, it's worth defending.
That, you know, that's so crazy, because that doesn't just resonate with men, right?
That's for men
and women, because people have this thing. Let's say I'm a creator, right? And I'm like, you know, my idea of being a woman and my ideologies can be totally different. Like, I'm not the woman that comes home and I'm sorry, I don't have dinner waiting for my man when he gets off work. You know, because mind is working 24/7. Like, I'm all over the place, so I'm not that woman. And don't get me wrong, I clean the house. I mean, I had a housekeeper for some time because I was so busy that I felt that the house was just getting, and I never want him to come home to a messy house. But sometimes I don't clean it. I just have to hire out because I know. But someone else may say to me, oh my God, you're not a woman because you don't take care of your man. You're not cooking for him every day. You know what I'm saying?
You define your womanhood. Exactly. You know what I'm saying? You define your womanhood. And it's funny because one of the men characters in Nobody Wants a Weak Man is a house husband.
Right.
And his wife sounds a little bit like you. you know, I think what we have to do is resist defining ourselves by who we're with and just go ahead and define ourselves before we get who we with. You know, at the end of the day, if you're not a cooker, you wasn't a cooker before you got with me.
Right.
You know who it was, you know what I'm saying? So, but it allows you the opportunity or the space to come into, let's say, a relationship. And that's any kind of relationship, being honest and open. And you never know, that other person coming in may be able to meet you where you're at. And that's what that particular couple does. And Nobody Wants a Weak Man. They kind of meet each other where they're at. You know, and there's some things that she does that, you know, people are like, oh, that wasn't no real woman stuff. And there's some stuff that he does or doesn't do where people can question, no, it's not some real man stuff. But he's defined what he is as a man. She's defined who she is as a woman. And they've been able to come together as a couple and do powerful things. So, yeah, it's definitely about, you know, operating, like I said, being honest and operating about who you are. You know what your mama told you. If it don't apply, let it fly.
But that is key in any relationship outside of the play in real life as well. Like, you can go, you start dating someone, and the person is showing you clearly who they are.
Absolutely.
They're showing you who they are. You can't date them and then marry them with the intent that they will change into something that you would more like want them to be. Right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
And that is the biggest problem that people, I think, are struggling with in relationships, because, I see the potential in him. If she was a bum when you were dating, Right? You can pray for him, pray for her all day. Yeah. Like, you know, I hope he gets his stuff together. I hope she gets it together. No, I'm just going to give her some time. Mm-hmm. I ain't got time to get you together as a grown person.
You know, it's funny that you bring that up, because one of the major themes that my plays deal with is marriage. I could even venture off, to be honest, and say that, you know, marriage is a theme that, you know, I've had my struggles, right, one way or another, right, in dealing with over the years. And I think one of we have to resist the urge to believe that marriage is some sort of magic wand. Mm-hmm. You know, if we go biblically or even through, a Christian perspective, or not even just Christian, a lot of religions, they advocate and
promote.
They acknowledge, yes, and promote the blessings that come out of marriage. And so I don't want to make people think like, oh, Silas is against me. No, I'm not against marriage. I do believe that marriage has blessings. But just because it has blessings don't mean that it show blessings. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And so when you're saying things like, you know, I see the potential and stuff like that, I'm trying to warn, you know, or when a person is saying those things, should I say, I'm sorry, that like they see potential, then, you know, I guess the next question will be, well, really, what does that look like? Because you don't want that to look like you thinking that a marriage is going to change them. And I think that's the last thing that changes a person, is the fact that they're married. You know, sometimes it's just who they are. You know, and like you said, you know, you hit the nail on the head earlier when you said, you know, they show you who you are when you're dating. If we've been dating for a year and I got the number of home cooked meals I done got is on one hand, I shouldn't be expecting a marriage to make you Betty Crocker. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, it that would be changing who you are. And that's funny too, because even in the play, there's another couple where one of the guys, right, he's kind of on the fence, right, about this marriage thing. And it's based off of this whole potential concept, right, where you have to kind of, it's almost like a battle between what my intentions are to be and who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And he battles with that, because, you know, you can want to do your best, but if you're not there, if you're not close there, then, you know, you can't marry just because you might be getting ready to do your best. You know what I'm saying? You got to get that together first. And what I tell people all the time is, look at what they're doing with their time. You know, it's one thing for a person to be, you know, struggling or a bum, right? And they play video games all day, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's another thing for a person to be struggling and a bum and they're hitting 25 interviews a week.
Right.
You get what I'm saying?
That's a total different situation.
That's a total different situation. So, you know, it's about, you know, sharpening your definition of what potential is. You know, potential ain't just somebody saying that they want to do better. Potential is somebody actually putting in effort. And really, I don't even like to say putting in effort, because people lie about their effort. I don't care what nobody say. People lie about their effort. Let me see what you do with your time.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
What you do with your time, that's going to show me really where your effort at. You can tell me you give an effort till you blue in the face, man.
That's
right.
True.
To the bed and take a nap. But you know what I'm saying? But when you put in that effort and it's reflected in your time, it's reflected in your man hours, then I know that this is somebody that really has the potential to do something. And that's somebody that I want to connect with.
Wow. I love it. Yeah. I love it. So now that we have part two, right?
Yes.
And
yes.
That's coming and playing when and where?
Well, the part two to Nobody Wants a Weak Man is the flip side. Nobody Wants a Weak Woman.
That's true too.
Yeah. Both equally true.
Yes. Yes, I agree.
Nobody Beats a Woman, and that will be September 11th, 2022. It is going down September 11th at the International Institute of Metropolitan Detroit, that's located in Detroit, Michigan, right across the street from the Detroit Institute of Arts. We have two shows, a matinee show at 4:30 and then a primetime show at 6:30. And I promise you, you do not want to miss it. You know, week woman was the total opposite of week man. Week man, it may have took me about 6 or 7 months to write. Week woman, it took me about 3 weeks to write. And I wrote it at my previous job. And the reason why it was able to flow right is because it's kind of what you said earlier when you said there was no difference really between men and the women. And so a lot of people, you know, what I tell people all the time is to make sure that they're at the second show, because what you begin to learn through these characters is that we all have our scrutinies.
Right.
Whether you're a man or a woman, you've been scrutinized by somebody for something. You know what I'm saying? And so, in my opinion, weak woman is just a flip side of scrutinies that are already going on in weak man. But these women now are being able to tell their side of the story. So I'm excited about it, man. And I definitely want to make sure that all of my ladies come out, because I represented for y'all just as hard as I represented for my fellas.
Listen. If you are in the Detroit area or the surrounding areas, now I don't really know what the surrounding areas of Detroit are, but
I understand. They do, though.
If you are in the surrounding areas of the Detroit, Michigan area, you need to cop your tickets ASAP before the show sells out, because I heard it was fire. So you better get your tickets. I don't care if it's for the matinee or the 6:30 show.
Yep.
Y'all need to get your tickets. And I think we had this conversation, you know, my son's birthday is the 14th and my man's mom's birthday is the 14th of September. So I'm not really sure what we're doing for them. But if we can finesse it, I'm out there for the show.
If y'all come out here, y'all got tickets.
Well, we better have tickets.
Y'all got tickets. I'm gonna give y'all some popcorn when y'all come. Y'all gonna get treated like kings and queens. Absolutely, man. Because it's so much love, and we want this to grow. You know, we're in Detroit. That's where the budget is now. But you have no idea. Like, it is my dream to get to New York, and the surrounding areas, and really bring what we're doing to you all, man. And to let you all be a part of it. You know, all of our actors and our production team pretty much now are from the Detroit area. But I'm waiting for the opportunity to be able to work with you, DeShonda. I really am. And I'm steadfast on being focused on creating that opportunity. You know, I tell you now, and this is just me being real, it's not something that I spend all day, every day working on, but it's definitely something that I think about every day. And so slowly but surely, the opportunity is going to come. And when it is, that's going to be even more fire. You know what I'm saying? Because, Detroit, New York going to come together.
You know, and ain't nothing like it. Ain't going to be nothing like it. You know, it's going to be an implosion. Not an explosion, an implosion. Okay. Because they ain't gonna even understand what it's like. You know what I mean?
Okay, that's that explosion on steroids.
So let me ask you. So if you were to give some advice to one of the listeners right now who's sitting at home, maybe one of our younger listeners who's saying, you know what? I think I want to start an online radio show. What advice would you give them?
When we started our radio show, the first thing that I did was went and researched. And it's, oh my goodness. I don't want to be too long-winded, right? But here's the thing. I'll give you this. We were watching a movie last night, right? I forget the name of the movie. You know, you just be on Netflix, Prime, whatever. So, come on. But in the movie, they were getting ready to do a heist, right? And they stood to make $150 million off of the heist. And he said, the first thing he said when he told them the amount that they had, that they could stand to make, was how much time they had to do recon and practice. You know what recon is. Recon is, getting background information, stuff like that. And so I turned to Ange and I said, if 8 weeks of recon get $150 million, right? What kind of recon can you do, right, in 8 weeks? And how much would that make at the end of the 8 weeks? And so if I give any advice, it would be that. Recon and planning is exactly what we did with the radio station. The tendency, right, when you get an idea like that, would be to go do something like create content, right? Stop playing with your camera, stuff like that. No, recon is important. Research information is important because one of the people I listen to is T.D. Jakes, and he says every jungle got its rules. I don't care what jungle you go into, whether it's online radio, whether it's starting your business, whether it's writing a play, whether it's doing a movie, whatever, it could be taken out the trash, right? It has its own rules. And so your first job is always to see what are the rules now, especially before you think about changing them. Right. Sometimes we get focused on changing the rules. Well, first you got to know what they are before you start to change them, because it could be somebody that's already doing what you're doing. But once you get that research in and you get to see what the market looks like, and you know, for those of y'all that may not understand what a market looks like, that's how much money that market makes. See, one of my previous majors in college was secondary education. And then I went back and did some research on the market, and I didn't like it.
Right. The numbers wasn't numbering, baby.
And so that's important. When that, like, no matter, like I said, no matter what it is that you're going into, research that market. See if people are even making money doing it already. If they are, see how they're making money doing it. Get some ideas together, and then come up with a plan of attack. And then I would say after that, just work your plan. My dad has a saying: "Your plan to work if you work it." You know what I'm saying? And so when you've done the necessary things to come up with a good, solid plan, the only thing left to do is work it. And work it means do what the plan says. It means improve on the plan. It means fine-tune the plan. It means come up with an even better plan. That's all what's a part of working your plan. And when you do all of that stuff, you'll have no choice but to move.
Okay, well, that sounds like a plan. So yeah. the plan is the plan, right?
The plan is the plan. And to have a good one. A plan is not just getting a sheet of paper and going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Right.
You know, your recon, your research information is what allows you to even be able to even think that you have a good plan. And that's why I mentioned the research first. You know, no matter what it is you're doing, you got to get an education in it first. Whether that be an hour a day education, a college education, high school, you have to get some sort of education in it first. But once you educate yourself, then you'll be able to come up with a plan of attack, and you work that plan.
I love it. I had a special guest pop in right now.
Oh, is that her?
Yes, that's her. So she came in, and her dad just dropped her off. So she's like, "Hey, what's going on here? I told you she was kind of upset. I didn't lock the out of the studio recording session here."
Yeah. So I don't know why you did that to her, Deshaun.
Because she gonna be jibber jabbering. So we not having that right now. See, she's not the co-host yet. When she becomes co-host and we could put her down for some credit, then she can run her mouth. But right now,
absolutely,
it's all about me. But I want to thank you for coming on the show and being such an inspiration to so many, and giving that advice of the recon. That is very important, right?
Thank you.
The research and make sure that you're prepared, because if you're not in a position of knowing what your competition is doing, you're not going to be ready. So,
Thank you so much for having me, Deshaun. I appreciate it. I'm honored that you even thought of me. I'm honored by the way that you had me on as a guest and everything. And to be honest with you, I'm honored to be connected to you. And that's why we had to have you. We got to have When the Blue Comes Off. Total Entertainment Radio ain't Total Entertainment Radio without When the Blue Comes Off with Deshaun the Car. You know what I'm saying?
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I'm definitely honored and I'm excited. And the way that I tell y'all all the time, but I'm so serious. The way that I honor you the most is by going to work for you. And that's what get me up. That's what keep me staying up late. That's what get me planning. When I know I got solid people like you, you know, doing what you're doing, then I got to come through for y'all. And I will. I will.
Oh, thank you so much, Salis. We love being on a part of the Total ENT Radio family. And we look forward to, you know, producing more shows and having more guests and being a part of the growth. And, you know, absolutely. You deserve
it. I'm looking forward to writing something for you, Deshonda. Since I'm on When the Blues Comes Off anyway, if y'all listening and tuning in, I have plans to write something for Deshonda Carter because she is so talented. That baby is so talented. Keisha called me about an hour ago. I got to return her call. Yeah, but, you know, that is definitely... And so don't be surprised when y'all see Deshonda Carter with Mustard Seed Productions doing something.
Listen, I already got it in my head. When we get off this interview, I'm getting ready to holler at you. So don't even worry about that. Listen, tell the people where they can find you, social media handles, so that they can reach out to you. Also, again, like I stated, anyone is interested in, you know, having a show that's really been dying and have an idea with some great, great content, you might want to reach out to Salis. So, Salis, tell them where they can find you.
Absolutely. You can find us on Facebook. You can follow us on Facebook at Total Entertainment Radio. You can also find us on Instagram at Total ENT Radio _. You can find us on Twitter at Total ENT Radio _ as well. I had to make sure I got that right. Make sure you check out our website at www.totalentradio.com. If you want to listen in through the website, all you have to do is hit the TER button right at the top and hit listen now. You can also listen through Facebook. If you go to our Total Entertainment Radio page, click the blue use app button at the top, and you can tune in there. And you can give us a call. We got old school methods too. You know, 313-217-1588. Again, I say it again, 313-217-1588. Like Deshonda said, if you're a content creator, if you got an idea for a show, if you want your business marketing on the station, to be honest with you, if you're anybody that's doing anything, give us a call. I promise you, you will not regret it, because one of the things that we're going to make sure that we do is be there for you. The same way we've been there for Deshonda and Angel Riley and everybody else there, that's been a part of us, because it's a blessing for us to be able to bless you. So make sure you hit us up on all platforms at Total ENT Radio or give us a call at 313-217-1588. It's either going to be me or Angel answering the phone, so you won't talk to us.
Well, thanks again, Salis, for being our special guest, and we look forward to speaking to you soon. And don't forget to get those tickets for September 11th for and I think, is there a link for that as well, or they can just contact you as well?
Just go to Mustard Seed Productions on Facebook. If you want tickets, you can leave us a message through Facebook, or we're also selling through the radio station. So the same number, 313-217-1588. If you want tickets for Nobody Wants a Weak Woman, like you said, it's going down September 11th in Detroit, Michigan, at the International Institute of Metropolitan Detroit. But listen here, make sure that you're tuned in to an all-new episode of When the Blue Comes Off every Thursday at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Deshonda, from day one, I was always impressed with your show. I was always impressed with your graphic design. I was always impressed with your formats. Your show was the show that we needed to, like I said, to be Total Entertainment Radio. You know, as we can be the radio station and the shows.
Right, right.
It's just impossible.
We too
just
much.
Be us. You know what I'm saying? So you're, like I said, your show is the format and the level of professionalism and the skill of interviewing. Interviewing is an art. Everybody can't do it.
Right.
Everybody can't do it, but you do it well. You do it with style. You do it with grace. And like I said, I'm honored to be connected to you, and I'm so honored to be on the show. So I'm going to keep shouting out When the Blue Comes On. Make sure you watch and you listen to it every Thursday at 4 p.m. I said it twice.
Thank you so much. So say bye-bye. Say bye-bye.
Bye.
I hope you guys enjoyed the show.
Bye-bye, baby.
And I look forward to bringing you many more, all with positive vibes. Remember, whatever you do, do it from the heart, with love and passion. Stay safe. Talk to you soon.